Bismillah, alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Continuing with our book of Imam Ibn Qudamah, Al-Maqdisi, rahimahullah ta'ala, Umdat al-Fiqh. Quick few questions, so if you can close your books, notebooks and books, just to review very quickly. What with the three forbidden times that the Imam mentioned? Where am I looking? Yes. Okay, after Fajr till sunrise. Okay, so you, I asked you the three, right? Not the five. So you say after Fajr till the sun, after Fajr till 15 minutes after sunrise. That's one. Good. When the sun is in the middle of the sky before it starts to move. Yes. After Asr to Maghrib. And then what are the two extra that the scholars they add to make it five? After sunrise for how long, we said? 15 minutes roughly, yeah. And then the second? 15 minutes before Maghrib. And why did the scholars they add these two extra times? Out of, though they are in the three times, why did they emphasize those two extra times? Because the prohibition to pray in that time is a shad, it's worse to pray in that time, okay? It's more severe as a prohibition in that time. Like, what are the exceptions, some of the exceptions that the Imam, he mentions from praying in the forbidden times? What can you pray in the forbidden times? Salat al-Duha, you cannot pray in the forbidden time. Salat al-Duha is after Shuruq al-Shams, after the sun has risen, and 15 minutes after that time. You can pray certain sunnahs that you need to make up.
Yes.
Two rak'ah after tawaf, you can pray at any time. Janazah, you can pray at any time, except for. What did we say the exceptions of? Exactly. So the long times. No, the long times are times you can't pray, exactly. So the exceptions are the short times, okay? The short times, which is 15 minutes after sunrise, and the time when the sun is at its meridian, and the time before the Maghrib, okay? These are the times when, what are we saying? For the janazah, right? When you shouldn't pray them, when you shouldn't pray the janazah, right? And in the long times, those are times where you can pray the janazah, okay? The long forbidden times. Because to keep the body for a long period of time would cause it to decompose or whatever to happen to it. Tayyib, what does the qa'idah that we mentioned, the rule? Al-qada yahki al-ada. Al-qada yahki al-ada. I mentioned it when talking about making up the salawat. What does that rule mean, if anybody can remember? That when you do the qada, it should be done in the same manner as doing the normal prayer, as you do it in normal prayer. And we gave an example of that. We said if you pray the sunnah of Fajr, okay, after Fajr, so it's qada, it should be done in the same manner, meaning that you pray it briefly, okay? And also with regards to praying the salawat, they should be done in order of time, etc., okay? Unless you're unable to do so. We'll stop there before we continue. I just wanted to mention something which is bothered me a little bit and been brought to my attention. When the class is taking place, we need to try to give full attention to what is being said, not because of the speaker. The speaker doesn't have the right to demand your attention, but what we are talking about, the words of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the words of the Prophet, the statements of the ulama, this has the right for you to demand your attention, that you sit quietly, you pay attention, side conversations, they don't take place. If you want to ask questions, try to hold off on those questions until the end of the lecture, okay? So this is general etiquettes that we must have when anybody is sitting in front of us speaking about the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as a reminder. The Imam, he says, Babul Imam, the chapter of the rulings pertaining to being an Imam. So he starts off with the hadith of Abu Masud al-Badri radiyallahu anhu, which is found in Sahih Muslim, wherein the Prophet ﷺ said, Ya Umm al-Qawm, أَقْرَأُهُمْ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ, that the person who should lead the people is the one who is أَقْرَأُهُمْ, The one who has the most recitation of the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. What does that mean? أَقْرَأُهُمْ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ. The most recitation. Does it mean that the one who recites most of the Quran, meaning he spends more hours of the day reciting the Quran? What do you think it means? The one who knows more Quran. Is it just sufficient to know the Quran? What else should be there? The understanding of the rules pertaining to the Salah. Okay, the understanding of the rules pertaining to the Salah. And also how to recite the Quran. Because many people, they know Quran, but they don't know how to recite the Quran properly, okay? So these three things need to be considered. The most important of them is the ability to recite the Quran correctly and the knowledge of the fiqh of the prayer. So it doesn't necessarily have to be the one who knows the Quran the most, okay? The other two things take precedence. The ability to recite the Quran with ahkam al-tajweed and to know the fiqh of the salah. So the Prophet ﷺ said in this hadith, يَا أُمَّ الْقَوْمِ أَقْرَأُهُمْ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ فَإِنْ كَانُوا فِي الْقِرَاءَةِ سَوَاءٍ فَأَعْلَمُهُمْ بِسُنَّةِ. If they are the same in the recitation of the Quran, then the one who knows the most sunnah. فَإِنْ كَانُوا فِي سُنَّةِ سَوَاءٍ فَأَقْدَمُهُمْ هِجْرَةً. If they are the same in the sunnah, then the one who made hijrah first. Okay, hijrah from Mecca to Medina. فَإِنْ كَانُوا فِي الْهِجْرَةِ سَوَاءٍ فَأَقْدَمُهُمْ سِلْمًا. And if even if in the hijrah they are the same, then the one that takes precedence is the one who is eldest in age. So what did the Prophet ﷺ say from the beginning? He mentioned the Quran, then he mentioned the Sunnah, then he mentioned the hijrah, and then he mentioned the age, right? And then the Prophet ﷺ said in the same hadith, وَلَا يَأُمَّنَّ الرَّجُلُ الرَّجُلَ فِي بَيْتِهِ وَلَا فِي سُلْطَانِهِ وَلَا يُجْلَسُ عَلَى تَكْرِمَتِهِ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. And if you are in a person's house, place of residence, or in a place like a majlis where the person would be sitting, you are not allowed to lead that person in salah, okay? Nor are you allowed to sit in his special place of sitting, if he has a special place of sitting, except with his permission. So the hadith is telling us after who should be leading the salah, also adding to that is that if you go to somebody's house and the person has the ability to lead the salah, it's not upon you to lead the salah in his house except with his permission, okay? Nor is it upon you to go and sit anywhere you want in the person's house. As many people have bad manners, they enter somebody's house, they just take a seat. Generally, you should wait for the person to tell you where to sit. Especially if you find that there's a type of seating, like you find in some of the majlises, that is kind of kept aside for somebody who has the respect of that family or of that tribe. So don't just go and sit anywhere in the majlis, wait till they sit you down. You've probably experienced this yourself, right?
They'll always tell you where to sit.
They always tell you where to sit, and this is good mannerisms. طيب. The Prophet ﷺ also mentioned in the other hadith which the Imam mentions, وقال المالك ابن حويرث وصاحبه, he said to Malik ibn Huwayrith and his companions, إِذَا حَضَرَتِ الصَّلَاةِ فَلْيُؤَذِّنْ أَحَدُكُمْ وَلِأُمَّكُمْ أَكْبَرُكُمْ. That if the time for prayer comes, then one of you should make the adhan. And the one to lead you in the prayer should be the eldest of you. Okay? But they were equal in recitation in the mention of this hadith. وَكَانَتْ قِرَاءَتُهُمَا مُتَقَارَبَةً. But the people in this hadith, the recitation was similar. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, the eldest of you should lead in prayer. The Imam, he says, وَلَا تَصِحُ الصَّلَاةُ خَلْفَ مَنْ صَلَاتُهُمْ فَاسِدًا. It's not permissible, or your salah will not be correct if you pray behind somebody whose prayer is going to be invalid. What does this mean? For example, if you being the ma'mum, you're praying behind the Imam, and somehow you came to know that the Imam doesn't have wudu. Like maybe you saw the Imam go to the bathroom, right? But he forgot to make wudu. You didn't see him make wudu. So you know for sure he didn't make wudu. Or for example, you know that the Imam is praying in the wrong qibla, the wrong direction. In this situation, it's not allowed for you to pray behind the Imam. Because the Imam's salah is fasid. It's incorrect, right? Due to him not having wudu and due to him not facing the qibla in the second example we gave. But the point is that you knew that this Imam, he didn't have wudu, nor was he facing the qibla. That's the important point, that you knew, you had knowledge of that. So in that case, you are not allowed to pray behind the Imam. طيب, the Imam, he carries on and he says, إِلَّا مَنْ لَمْ يَعْلَمْ حَدَثَ نَفْسِهِ. Except for the one who doesn't know that he has broken his wudu or he doesn't have wudu. وَلَمْ يَعْلَمْهُ الْمَعْمُومُ حَتَّى سَلَّمَ فَإِنَّهُ يُعِيدُهُ وَحْدَهُ. So the imam is saying the exception from the first case I gave you, where you cannot pray behind an imam who doesn't have wudu, or he's not facing the qibla, is if you've prayed behind him, and the imam, he didn't know that he had broken, that he didn't make wudu, or that he was facing the wrong direction. Nor did the ma'mum know. So neither imam knew, nor the one praying behind the imam knew, until the salah was over. So what happens in that situation? Our imam, he says, that the only one who repeats the salah is the imam. The ma'mumin, the ones who are praying behind the imam, they don't need to repeat the salah. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ said in Sahih Bukhari, speaking about leaders that will come towards the end of time who will be evil, the Prophet ﷺ said, يُسَلُّونَ لَكُمْ فَإِنْ أَصَابَعُوا فَلَكُمْ وَلَهُمْ فَإِنْ أَخْطَعُوا فَلَكُمْ وَعَلَيْهِمْ. They will pray, and if they got it correct and right, then it's for you and for them. But if they got it wrong, it's for you, but not for them. If they got it wrong, it's for you, but not for them. And also you find in the Muwatta of Imam Malik, Rahimullah Ta'ala, and the Musannaf of Ibn Abi Shaybah, that Umar radiallahu anhu once prayed with the people. And after finishing the prayer, he went away. And then later on, he found that actually he was in a state of janabah. So he prayed with the people while he was in a state of janabah, not having tahara whatsoever. He repeated the prayer himself, but he did not command the people to repeat the prayer. So it's very clear that this situation which the imam has mentioned has been found in the Salaf, and also based upon the hadith that we mentioned. So the point being that if you pray behind an imam and you found out later that the imam prayed without wudu, your salah is correct, but his salah would be incorrect. Our imam, he says, وَلَا تَصَحُّ خَلْفَ تَارِكُ رُكْنٍ. Nor is the prayer going to be valid behind an imam who leaves off one of the rukns of the prayer. What he means here is not that he leaves off forgetfully in the prayer, but he means that, for example, the imam, he cannot make a ruku, for example, he has a problem in his back, or he cannot stand up in the salah. Okay? So if there's an imam that cannot stand straight in the salah, or cannot make ruku due to issues with his back or something of this sort, then it's not permissible for you to pray behind this imam. Why? Because the ulama, they give the ta'lil, they give the understanding that the salah of the one who is complete should not be built upon the one who is incomplete. So the salah of the imam, if he cannot make the ruku, or if he cannot stand properly, his salah is incomplete because he's missing a rukun. Your salah behind him will be complete because you can do those actions. So it's not permissible for you to pray behind him in that situation. But now the imam, he gives exceptions. He says, إِلَّا إِمَامَ الْحَيِّ. Except for the imam who has a position to be the imam in the masjid of a particular area. Meaning he's that imam who has been given the job to be the official imam in that particular area. This guy is exempt from the previous rule that I just mentioned. إِذَا صَلَّ جَالِسًا. If this imam, he prays sitting down. لِمَرَضٍ يُرْجَى بُرْءُهُ. Due to a sickness or an inability that is temporary. The imam is going to be cured from that. It's not a permanent inability. It's a temporary inability. فَإِنَّهُمْ يُصَلُّونَ وَرَاءُهُ جُلُوسًا. For verily, they pray behind this imam sitting down like the imam is sitting down. The imam, he cannot stand, but it's a temporary sickness. It's not going to stay with him every time he comes to the masjid. It's maybe for a week or a few weeks, right? So what they do with this imam, they pray behind him, but they pray sitting down like he is sitting down. So this is an exemption to the rule that I mentioned a few moments ago, where I said that the imam is saying you cannot pray behind an imam who leaves out a rukn. So this is the exemption. What was the exemption? That he has to be which imam? The official imam of the community, okay? And the second thing, it's temporary sickness, it's temporary inability. So what you do in this situation, you pray behind the imam, but you pray sitting down. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامِ لِيُؤْتَمَّ بِي. Verily the imam has been made to be followed. فَلَا تَخْتَلِفُ عَلَيْهِ. So do not differ with him. And at the end of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا صَلَّ جَالِسًا فَصَلُّ جُلُوسًا أَجْمَعُونَ. If he prays sitting down, then all of you pray sitting down. طيب. Our imam, rahimahullah ta'ala, he goes on to say, إِلَّا أَنْ يَبْتَدِئَهَا قَائِمًا. Again, he gives another exception to this rule. He says, unless the imam who has this issue that you are praying behind, He starts to pray standing up. So the Imam starts praying as normal, standing up, right? ثُمَّ يَعْتَلْ. But then something happens to him and he's unable to stand anymore. So he sits down. فَيَجْلِسُ فَإِنَّهُمْ يُتِمُّونَ مَعْهُ قِيَامًا. So what do the people behind him do in this situation? They don't sit down, they continue praying behind him, standing up, even though he's sitting down. Why? What's the difference? The difference is that he started the salah praying standing, right? But then something took place which caused him to sit down because he couldn't stand due to his issues in his back. So in this situation, the people, they don't sit down with the imam, they continue praying with the imam standing. Tayyib? So it's different to the first situation that we mentioned. In Sahih Bukhari, it's narrated that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he was leading the people in prayer, standing. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came out sick to take over from Abu Bakr because he wanted to lead the people in prayer, continue from Abu Bakr sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But he was unable to stand. So he prayed sitting down. What did the companions do? They didn't sit down, they continued to pray standing up. Why? Because the imam, he started praying sitting down. So when do you sit down? You sit down if the imam, he starts the prayer sitting down. Tayyib? But if he starts the prayer standing up and then has to sit down, you continue the prayer standing up. The imam, he says, may Allah have mercy upon him, وَلَا تَصَحُّ إِمَامَةُ الْمَرْأَةِ. And it's not permissible to have a woman as an imam. What does this mean? Can she not be an imam ever?
She can be
imam for the women, not for the men in any situation, okay? So when the kuffar, those who want to attack Islam all the time and cause confusion, they come with this issue about why the woman cannot pray in front of the men, lead the men in the salah, then we shouldn't entertain this issue. We shouldn't even discuss it, because this is something which is in our Islamic theology and fiqh. It's been there for 1400 years. It's well known and it's well clear amongst the ulama as ijma, as consensus, that the woman cannot lead the salah. So when they come with these issues to poke at the Muslims and to keep them busy having to make rebuttals and having to debate, don't get involved in that stuff. It's something which is well known. Just tell the people to go back to the Islamic history, the Islamic fiqh, and they will find the answers that they need. The Prophet ﷺ said in Bukhari, خَيْرَ صُفُفُ الرِّجَالِ أَوَّلُهَا وَشَرُّهَا آخِرُهَا وَخَيْرُ صُفُفُ النِّسَاءِ آخِرُهَا وَشَرُّهَا أَوَّلُهَا. The Prophet ﷺ said in Bukhari that the best row for the men is the front of them, right? And the worst of the rows for the men is the last of them. The best row for the women is the last of them. And the worst of them is the front of them. So if the woman, she leads the salah, she's put this hadith on its head. She's turned it upside down. Therefore the women, they cannot lead the salah, okay? Except and unless they are praying with the women in a jama'ah which is only for women. The imam, he also says now, وَلَا مَنْ بِهِ سَلَسُ الْبَوْلِ. And also this person cannot be an imam. The one who has سَلَسُ الْبَوْلِ. Those of you who did fiqh al-tahara with me many years ago and did with Sheikh Maqsood, Hafidhullah, what is سَلَسُ الْبَوْلِ? Time to wake up, huh? Some of you brothers. What is سَلَسُ الْبَوْلِ? You took it before. You took it before. Sentence, Jazakallah khair. So what's happening with this person is that he has a urinal problem with his urine. Okay, it doesn't stop. Drops, they come every so often. This is known as salas al-bawl. So the imam here is saying that the one who has salas al-bawl, he cannot lead the salah either. Why is that? Because his tahara, the ruling of the one who has salas al-bawl, okay, outside of being an imam, is that he has to wash his private parts, okay, before every salah, and then he has to make as much protection in that area as possible. And then he carries on praying his prayer, even though the urine drops will come, okay, because it's something he cannot avoid. But as for him being the imam, he cannot be the imam, they say, because his allowance to pray is only for himself. That purity that he has is only for himself, because he has a durura. And the ulama, they give a rule in fiqh, الدرورة تقدر بدرورتها. الدرورة تقدر بدرورتها. The necessity is determined only due to the amount that is required. So when you allow to break the rules in Islam due to necessity, It's only for the amount which is required. And the amount which is required here of breaking the rule is for that person himself. Okay, it's not for him to be an imam. So this is the opinion of our imam and the Hanbali scholars and those who agree with them, that the one who has salas al-bawl, he cannot lead the salah because of this. And also because his purity is not as complete as the purity of those who don't have this issue. So they say this is another ta'lil, this is another reason. طيب, Imam al-Shafi'i and Imam Malik, as mentioned by Sheikh Abdul Aziz al-Rajihi in his explanation of this book, he says that they allow the one who has salas al-bawl to lead the salah, different to our imam and the Hanbali scholars. Why? Why do you think? What's their understanding for the imam who has salas al-bawl to be able to be the imam? Ahsanta, jazakallahu khair. If he can pray for himself, meaning his salah is valid for himself, then it's valid for everybody else. Tayyib, his salah is valid for him, right? Therefore, it's valid for everybody else to pray behind him. This is what they're saying, Imam Shafi, Imam Malik. Though Imam Malik says it's recommended still for to somebody who has wudu, to complete wudu, complete tahara, to be the imam. Tayyib. The imam, he says, وَالْأُمِّ الَّذِي لَا يُحْسِنُ الْفَاتِحَ. And the ummi, what's ummi? Ummi is normally known as the one who cannot read, yeah? The one who cannot speak properly, the one who doesn't have the ability to read. وَالْأُمِّ الَّذِي لَا يُحْسِنُ الْفَاتِحَ. The ummi who cannot, who has not memorized al-Fatiha. So according to the ulama al-Fiqh, if you haven't memorized Surah al-Fatiha, you are ummi. Okay? You are given this title of being ummi, which is normally given to somebody who's uneducated, unable to read. لا يحسن الفاتحة أو يخل بحرف منها. Or he makes mistakes in its pronunciation. إلا بمثلهم. Unless everybody behind that imam is the same as him, meaning none of them have the ability to recite Surah Al-Fatiha properly. Only in that situation can the imam who hasn't memorized Fatiha or is unable to recite it properly can be the imam in that situation. Why? Why cannot somebody who doesn't know Fatiha or is unable to recite Fatiha properly be the imam? Not you. I want the guys who've been studying here. But jazakallah khair.
One thing, a mispronunciation could change the meaning.
I sent the mispronunciation will change the meaning maybe. But so what does that lead to? Apart from changing the meaning. Fatiha is a what of the salah? Good, you're right, but it's not a fard of the salah, it's a what? Rukn of the salah. So the one who's not doing Fatiha, he's leaving a rukn of the prayer. Therefore, his salah is not going to be valid, nor will the salah be valid of the ones behind him. Tayyib. And we said also, it's not just about memorizing Fatiha, it's about pronouncing Fatiha. So listen to my recitation. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. What were the mistakes there? Huh? There was no ha. I said ha. What else? Where was the ayn missing? In Alameen. I said Alameen is the Alameen. And these are common mistakes. You hear even the imams who are proper imams in the masajid, they have beautiful voices, but if you listen carefully, there are mistakes in the recitation. So it's something which is imperative that we need to correct our recitation, sitting with somebody who's a proficient reciter. Go to an expert, sit with him, and try to drill Surah Al-Fatiha as much as you can. Because it may be the case that you're changing the meanings by mispronouncing the words, or you're not giving the letters of Surah Al-Fatiha the right. You're not doing the shadda. What's a shadda? A shadda means that there's two letters. Okay? So if you're not giving the shadda, it means you're dropping one of the letters. So this is a serious problem. We need to spend time reciting and learning Surah Al-Fatiha with an imam who has the ability to teach if possible. The imam, he says, وَيَجُوزُ الْإِتِمَامَ الْمُتَوَدِّئِ بِالْمُتَيَمَّمِ. It's permissible for the one who has wudu to pray behind the one who has tayammum. It's permissible to pray behind the one who has tayammum, okay, even though everybody behind him has wudu. Which is stronger, wudu or tayammum? Wudu, right? Wudu is the correct tahara. Tayammum is therefore need. The ulama, they say it's mubih, it's not rafi'. Mubih means permissible due to need. Rafi' means that it actually removes the impurity, and it removes the state of being impure. So wudu is rafi', it removes the state of hadith. Tayammum is mubih, it gives you the permissibility to pray with tayammum for that period of time because you do not have water or any other reason for which you need to have tayammum. So the Imam here is saying that the mutawaddi, the one who has wudu, can pray behind the one who has tayammum. And the evidence for that you will find in Abi Dawood, and Imam Ahmed also collects it, where Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhu was once on an expedition. He came into a state of janaba, but because it was so cold, he didn't want to make ghusl, so he made tayammum instead, right? And then he led his companions in salah. He led his companions whilst he was in the state of tayammum from janaba. And his companions behind him, they had wudu. When they got to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they complained about this situation. So Amr was asked by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said, "Ya Amr, salaita bi ashabika wa anta junub." Oh Amr, you prayed behind, you led your companions in prayer while you were junub. So remember, I was saying that there's a difference between rafi' and mubih. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "While you're in junub." So the hadith goes on, Amr, he said, "Dhakartu li Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam ma mana'ani min al-ikhtisal." I mentioned to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that which prevented me from making ghusl, which was that it was extremely cold. He was fearful for his health. Okay, that if he made ghusl in that extreme cold, he could, you know, destroy his health. And then he said, "Sami'tu Allah azza wa jalla yaqul, wala taqtulu anfusakum inna Allah kana bikum rahima." He said, "I heard Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the Quran, don't kill yourselves, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful to you." فَضَحِكَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ شَيْءٍ. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم laughed at him after he gave that reply, and he didn't say anything. So in this hadith is a clear proof that if somebody prays with tayammum, leading those who have wudu, then it's permissible. Okay, and also it's a clear proof for those who say that tayammum is mubih and not rafi'. Why? Because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم صَلَيْتَ بِأَصْحَابِكَ وَأَنْتَ جُنُبٍ. You pray with your companions whilst you were state of janaba. طيب. Let me just summarize that very quickly without the extra information. The Imam is saying that if you've made tayammum, it's permissible for you to pray to lead those who have wudu. Okay? The Imam, he now says, وَالْمُفْتَرِدْ بِالْمُتَنَفِّلْ. You can pray behind an Imam who is praying nafil, though you are intending to pray fard. You can pray behind an Imam who is praying a nafil, though you are praying a fard or intending to pray a fard. Why? Excuse me. Because in Bukhari Muslim, Jabir radiallahu anhu narrates that Mu'ad kana Mu'ad radiallahu anhu yusalli ma'an Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-isha al-akhira thumma yarji ala qawmihi fayusalli bihim tilka salah. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pray Mu'ad used to pray with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the last isha. What does he mean by the last Isha? There are two Ishas. Isha is, Maghrib is also known as Isha, okay? The last Isha, Isha al-Akhir, they mean Salat al-Isha, the one that we just prayed now. So Mu'ad would pray with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam Salat al-Isha, and then he would return to his people and he would pray with them the same prayer. So he would be leading as mutanaffil with praying nafil, and those behind him would be praying with the intention of praying fard. So in this situation, the ulama, they say that it's permissible to do so. طيب. Now how do we reconcile what we've just said with what we mentioned before in the hadith where the imam, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, جُعِلَ الْإِمَامْ لِيُؤْتَمَّ بِهِ. The imam has been made to be followed. فَلَا تَخْتَلِفُ عَلَيْهِ. So do not differ with him. Because those opponents of this opinion, they come with this hadith as one of their proofs. Those who say you cannot do this, they bring this hadith where the Prophet said, do not differ with the imam. So how do we reconcile between these two issues? That we have this hadith and yet we have the action of Mu'ad radiallahu anhu and others.
We don't differ with the actions.
Ahsant, it's not the amur al-bataniyah. It's not the internal things, it's the apparent things, which are the actions. So you don't differ with the actions. And the proof of that is in the hadith itself, when the Prophet said, فَإِذَا كَبَّرَ فَكَبِّرُ وَإِذَا رَكَعَ فَارْكَعُ. Whenever the imam does an action, you do it after him. So he's talking about the actions, not the inner actions, which is the differing of the intention. طيب, just a bit more to go. Stay with me, brothers. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَإِذَا كَانَ الْمَأْمُومُ وَاحِدًا. If the imam, if the ma'mum is one, okay? وَقَفَ عَنْ يَمِينِ الْإِمَامِ. He stands on the right of the imam. فَإِنْ وَقَفَ عَنْ يَسَارِهِ أو قدامه أو وحده لم تصح صلاته. So if that person praying with the imam is one, he should stand on the right. If he stands in front of him or on the left of him, then according to our imam, the salah is invalid. طيب. So where should the person stand if he is one? He should stand on the right. He shouldn't stand in front, nor should he stand on the left. طيب. The majority of the ulama, they allow this person to stand on the left. They say it's not the sunnah, but if he prays on the left of the imam, then his salah will be valid and not invalid. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ in Bukhari once, he was praying in the house of Maymuna radiallahu anha, and Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu stood up to pray with the Prophet ﷺ. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu stood on the left of the Prophet ﷺ. What did the Prophet ﷺ do? He took him by the ear and he brought him to the right. Where's the proof? Exactly. So the Prophet ﷺ didn't push him away to say, like, you have broken your prayer. All he did, he took him from the left to the right. So if it had been an invalidator of the prayer, then the Prophet ﷺ would not have allowed him to carry on the prayer with him on the right. So he took him from the left, meaning that he started part of the prayer on the left. He took him from the left to the right, and he allowed him to continue on the prayer. If the prayer was to be invalid because he started on the left, the Prophet would not have done that. He would have told him somehow to go away or to repeat his prayer. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tayyib. So the majority say it's allowed if the person does do that, meaning that the salah is permissible. What if the person, the imam, he also said, if the person prays, what did he say? If he prays behind him, okay, alone. Meaning, what he means here is that if there's a jama'ah taking place and one person prays behind the row by himself, in this situation the salah is not valid based upon narrations of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But there's an exception to this rule. What's the exception?
There's no space for you to go to his right.
That's it. If there's no space for you to get into the row, okay, then you're allowed to pray behind by yourself. Why? Because there is a durura. It's a necessity. You're not intending to do it. It's for the one who intends to break away from the row and pray by himself. This person's prayer will be invalid. The imam, he also mentioned, and also the one who prays in front of the imam. Why can't you pray in front of the imam? Based upon the hadith that we keep mentioning. The imam has been made to be followed. So if you're in front of the imam, you cannot follow the imam. طيب. Our imam, may Allah have mercy upon him, he says, إِلَّا أَن تَكُونَ إِمْرَأَ فَتَقِفُ وَحْدَهَا خَلْفَهُ. Unless it's a woman, then she is allowed to stand by herself behind the group, or behind the imam, right? She's allowed to stand by herself behind the imam, or behind the row of men, or of men. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ said in Sahih Muslim, it's narrated that Anas radiallahu anhu, he said, صليت أنا ويتيم في بيتنا خلف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأمي أم سليم خلفنا. He said, I prayed with the Prophet ﷺ. Anas said, I and an orphan prayed with the Prophet ﷺ in our house behind the Prophet ﷺ. And our mother Um Sulaim, she prayed behind us. My mother Um Sulaim, she prayed behind us. So the woman, she has to pray behind the men. Okay? وَإِن كَانُوا جَمَعَةً وَقَفُوا خَلْفَهُ. And if it's a group of people praying behind the imam, where do they stand? They stand behind the imam. طيب. Starting from where? Starting from behind the imam, going to the right and going to the left. Okay? فَإِن وَقَفُوا عَنْ يَمِينِهِ أَوْ عَنْ جَانِبَيْهِ صَحْ. And if this group of people praying behind the imam, they stand on the right of the imam, okay, or they stand on both sides of the imam with the imam in the middle, then the prayer is valid. What should they be doing? The row of the people praying behind the imam, they should be where? Behind the imam. But now this situation, the imam is mentioning, the imam is in the middle, a group have stood on his right, not behind him, and a group have stood on his left, not behind him. Or they've all stood on his right. Both cases are okay, the salah will be valid, okay? But the sunnah and the better is for you to stand obviously behind the imam. وَإِن صَلَّتْ إِمْرَأَ بِالنِّسَاءِ قَامَتْ مَعْهُنَّ فِي الصَّفْ وَسْطًا. If a woman prays with the jama'ah of women, where should she pray? In the middle of them, not in front of them, in the middle of them. And the illa for this, the reasoning for this, because the ulama, they say this is أكثر التسطر. This is more concealing for her. Because the women, Allah loves them to conceal themselves. So when she's praying in the middle, it's more concealment for her. Therefore, it's better for, it's, she should pray in the middle of the women if it's the case that it's one row like this, okay? She should pray in the middle of the row. وَكَذَلِكَ إِمَامُ الرِّجَالِ الْأُرَاتِ يَقُومُ وَسْطُهُمْ. Likewise, the imam, if he's in a situation, may Allah preserve the Muslims and protect them from all harm. I mean, if he's in a situation where he has to pray naked. For example, he's in a prison. And in some prisons, you know, they're very oppressive. They cause the people to live, to stay without clothing. So in this situation, if he has to pray with the congregation, he should pray in the middle of the congregation. Tayyib, not stand in front of them unless it's dark. Unless it's clearly dark and no one can see what is taking place. When istama'a rijalun wa sibyan, and if in the jama'ah behind the imam there is men and there are children, okay, wa khunatha, and there are khunatha, I forget the English word, khunatha, the ones who don't have their genitals clearly defined. That long word, right? They don't have their genitals clearly defined, right? So if they're there also, it's the men, it's the children, then it's those who don't have their genitals clearly defined. Okay, and then it's the women behind them. So if there's a mix of people like that, like there's women present, there's children present, there's men present, and there's the hermaphrodites, then who goes first? The men go first. Then who's after the men? The children. And after the children, hermaphrodite, and after the hermaphrodites, the women. Okay? The imam, he says, وَمَنْ كَبَّرَ قَبْلَ سَلَامَ الْإِمَامِ فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَ الْجَمَاعَ. How much time have we taken so far? 7 minutes. And I did put a warning on the group that it could be up to 15 minutes, right? So maybe some of you are not on the group. طيب. So the imam, he says, وَمَنْ كَبَّرَ قَبْلَ سَلَامَ الْإِمَامِ فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَ الْجَمَاعَ. Whoever makes the takbir before the imam has made the taslim, then he gets the reward of the jama'ah. Then he has caught the jama'ah. What is he saying? If you get to the masjid and the imam is about to make taslim and you say Allahu Akbar, right? Before the imam makes the taslim, you have considered having got the jama'ah. You have considered having caught the jama'ah according to this opinion. Why? Because he's considered to have caught part of the salah. Wa salah la yatajazza. The salah cannot be divided into separate parts. It's one action. So if you catch one of the action, you're considered as having caught it all. And also the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَأَتِمُّوا وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَصَلُّوا. فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَأَتِمُّوا. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the hadith where he said, you know, if the iqamah is made, then don't rush to the masjid. Okay? Go to the masjid with tranquility. فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا. That which you catch with the imam, you pray. وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ, and that which you miss, فَأَتِمُّوا. So where's the proof in this hadith? The proof is where he says, فَأَتِمُّوا, complete. So if you've caught something with the imam, he's telling you, the Prophet ﷺ, to complete it. Therefore, he's telling you that you have caught the jama'ah, so just complete the rest which you missed out. So that's the proof in the hadith. Those who say no, the other opinion, those who say no, they say because of the hadith in Abi Dawood, where the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا جِئْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ وَنَحْنُ سُجُودٍ. Okay, if you come to the masjid and we are in sujood, فَسْجُدُوا وَلَا تَعُدُّهَا شَيْئًا. Pray that sujood with us, but don't consider it to be anything. Don't consider it to be that you've caught the salah due to that. وَمَنْ أَدْرَكَ الرَّكَى فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَ صَلَاةً. The one who catches a rak'ah, then he has caught the salah. So the Prophet ﷺ is saying in Abi Dawood that if you come to the masjid and you find us in a position of sujood, then make that prostration with us, but do not consider it to be anything. And the one who catches the rak'ah, okay, then he has considered to have caught the jama'ah. So the second opinion is that you catch the jama'ah by catching one rak'ah. And also in this hadith is an important point. We find many people when they come to the masjid and the jama'ah is in sujood, they make the mistake. What is their mistake? They stay standing. They don't get into the salah where the imam is. They wait for the imam to come back up. The hadith is clearly saying to us, no, you should join the imam in any position that he is in. And just another point with regards to trying to catch the jama'ah. This is something very important. The fadila of the jama'ah, the virtue of praying in congregation is so virtuous and so much reward. There are, you know, nearly endless ahadith talking about this. For example, the Prophet ﷺ said in Tirmidhi, narrated by Anas radiallahu anhu, من صلى لله 40 يوما في الجماعة يدرك تكبيرة الأولى كتبت له براءة بَرَاءَةٌ مِنَ النَّارِ وَبَرَاءَةٌ مِنَ النِّفَاقِ. Whoever prays 40 days in the masjid for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, catching the first takbir, then it will be written for him that he will be free from two things: free from the fire and free from hypocrisy. So catching the jama'ah has so much virtue. It's something we should rush to do. We shouldn't be of those who say, okay, it doesn't matter, as long as I get there before the taslim is made, I've caught the jama'ah. No, you want to get there as early as possible. طيب. The imam, he says, وَمَنْ أَدْرَكَ الرُّقُوعَ فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَ الرَّكَعَ وَإِلَّا فَلَا. The imam, he says, whoever catches the ruku', then he has caught the rak'ah. So the imam is now telling you how you catch the rak'ah, in his opinion. You catch it by catching the ruku', okay? If you don't catch the ruku', then you haven't caught the rak'ah. If you don't catch the ruku' with the imam, then you haven't caught the rak'ah. What if somebody comes and he's catching the imam with the ruku', but as soon as he gets into the position of the ruku', the imam gets up? Is he still considered to have caught the ruku'?
If the imam hasn't said Sami Allahu Liman Hamid, then caught the ruku'.
So again, you've come into the masjid, the imam's in ruku'. You've got into ruku', right? But as soon as you got into the ruku', the position, the imam got up. So you didn't get to say Subhana Rabbi Al-Azim. You didn't get to say it.
You caught
the ruku'. Huh? The majority in fact say no, you have caught it. Because they allow that as long as you got the position of the ruku', you can make the tuma'nina afterwards. Tuma'nina means that you should say Subhana Rabbi Al-Azim once at least. Okay, they say you can do this afterwards. So this makes it easy for a lot of people, because many of us, we used to think that if you get to the ruku', you have to say at least once Subhana Rabbi Al-Azim for you to have caught that rak'ah. But the imam and the majority, they say no, it's enough just for you to get into the ruku', and then you could do the tuma'nina after that. And also one important point just before we finish is that if you're in that situation where you're catching the imam just before he's getting up for ruku', Allahu Akbar and I go into ruku', do I have to make two takbirs? Is it Allahu Akbar, takbirat al-ihram, and then I have to make the takbir for the ruku' as well? Or does it suffice to say Allahu Akbar? The ulama, they differ over this, right? The majority, they say, okay, and the Hanbali scholars, they say the first one suffices. It suffices for you just to say Allahu Akbar, and that will suffice you to go into ruku' with that as well. You do not have to make the second takbirah, okay? Just an interesting piece, point of information there. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I rushed the last few parts because I could see people were getting tired, but it's no problem. It's difficult to be here after Isha. May Allah Zawajal increase your reward and blessings for having attended, and anything which was correct was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The shortcomings and mistakes were from myself and Shaitan. If you have any questions pertaining to what we said or clarifications, then feel free to go ahead. Fadl.